That's good to be in the house of God. Good to see y'all on Sunday morning. God is good. Let's all look to Him right now. Father, we love You today. Thankful to be in this place. Thankful to be worshiping with this people. Thank You for Your Spirit. Thank You for the love we feel when we come through the door. Oh God, bless us today. Lift us up above the shadows. Bless the church everywhere we're meeting together in Your name. And those who are not able to be here, You bless them also, Father. And we'll thank You for our Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Matthew 7:7-12. Great.
Amen.
All right. Awesome. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord hath made.
Amen.
Ask and it shall be given. You seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you.
For everyone that asketh is received, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened.
Or what man is there of you who, if his son ask bread, will he give him a stone?
Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent?
If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is heaven, give good things to them that ask him?
Therefore all things are treasured to you. For this is the law and the prophets.
Amen. That it? Passes. Maybe it's missed.
Short
reading.
Short.
God is altogether lovely.
Hey, that's
God is altogether lovely. Brother Pat, have you ever had one of those days where you had like five different scriptures and you didn't know any one of them? I searched last night. I was on a computer with my husband. Like, you're on a computer for hours. But what you need to understand is I was on there. They have this. It's called Bible Gateway. And once you get in there and you start reading, then I go from one scripture to another scripture to another scripture back to another scripture over to another scripture to another. And there were so many things in my mind. And basically what God wanted, I could just sit up here and say what God wants you to know today is don't be deceived. God wants you to treat people the way you want to be treated. That's basically, in a nutshell, what God wants you to know today. If you want people to treat you kindly, you have to treat them kindly. If you want people to be merciful to you, then you have to be merciful to them. And if you want God to move in your life, then you have to step up and say, Lord, I need some changes in my life. Help me to make those changes. And so much, we go through so many things in the world today that sometimes we're pushed off our ground. We're pushed backwards. I mean, sometimes I feel like I'm doing a two-step backwards, one step up, two-step backwards, one step up. And then all of a sudden God will come in, he'll give me this verse, and I'll feel like I'll make 20 steps forward. It's an amazing leap, but you just feel like you just jumped over a hurdle. And God is just altogether lovely today. He is so good. I just thank him and I praise him so much. I praise him for his mercy and his grace. I praise him for his love and his kindness. I praise him because he's with me. And above all things, I praise God for peace today.
Amen.
I praise God for peace today. I have peace in my spirit. How many of you today, you don't have to raise your hand, but search through your heart. How many of you have peace today?
Amen.
Peace
Amen.
In your heart to know that God is in control. I don't have to understand anything that's going on in this world. I don't have to understand what's going on in Sister Georgianne's life to pray for her.
That's right.
I don't have to come in and say, Sister Georgianne, what all is going on in your life? So I know exactly how. Tell me all the stuff. Let me know everything. What's going on? I need to know everything so I know exactly how to pray. I don't have to know everything.
God will show you if he wants you to pray.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We don't have to know everything that's going on in everyone's life to know how to pray for them. It's called intercessory prayer. Intercessory prayer. God knows the needs of his children. God knows what needs to be taken care of. Now, if you would all please just lift your hands and give God honor and glory and ask Him to bless this word to me. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, mighty God, I come before you today and I thank you and I praise you for your mercy and your grace and your goodness. I thank and praise you, Lord Jesus, for your word, because your word is what will lead us and guide us to truth. Your word, Lord God, and infilling of the Holy Spirit, Lord God, that comforter that you promised that you would send to us that will give us peace beyond all understanding. That comfort us, that will give us knowledge and understanding, Lord God. Will show us how to walk and how to speak, Lord God. Will show us where it is that we need to be. Lord, I thank you for the Holy Ghost today. I thank you for the Word today, Lord God. I thank you for the written Word of God, Lord Jesus, that will move upon us and lead us and guide us and show us. Lord, I ask that you would bless the Word today. Open our ears, Lord Jesus. Open our hearts that we can receive that Word with gladness. Oh, I just thank and praise you today for mercy and grace and goodness. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Well, I'm reading out of a chapter that wasn't even planned today, because this was the first thing God gave me. Then He gave me something else, and and then I opened up my Bible, and it with no markers, and it opens right up to where I was at last night. So I don't know about you, but I really feel like God just wants us to read this. Let me make just a reading. If I don't do anything else today, but just read the Word of God, you will receive something. Because the Bible says, my Word will not return unto you in void. This is the Word. This is the Word that will save you. This is the Word that will keep you. This is the Word that will give you understanding. This is the Word that will give you peace and knowledge. This is the Word that will keep you in a time that you don't think you can be kept. The Word of God is an amazing thing. Okay.
Yeah, you're fine. Something's ringing back. All the mics are ringing back. Okay.
The Word of God is all
yours. I said, I think it was yours.
If you would turn to Galatians chapter 3. That ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you. This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain? If it be yet a man. Sometimes we go through struggles and we go through trials and troubles and we don't understand why am I going through this? There's a reason for it. You're not suffering in vain. Whatever you're going through, there's a purpose and there's a reason for it. And when you get through it, you're going to have an aha moment of, now I understand what God was trying to show me. I understand what God was telling me. I understand why I'm where I'm at today. Everything we go through is to strengthen us, to encourage us, to give us hope, and to let us know that we have a God that we can depend on. God is not like men. God is not like women. God is not like humanity. God is not like humans that He gives a promise and takes it back. God is not like that. He is not like that at all. You have politicians and you have judges and you have rulers over you that promise you the world. A chicken in every pot. It's going to be wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Until you find out that you're human beings and you can only do what you can do. It's like a kid that's running for class president. I promise there'll be no more homework. We will never, if I become class president, there will never be another ounce of homework ever again.
Can't do that. That's a state.
Yeah. I promise a 5-hour lunch hour.
Yeah.
Recess after every class.
You're voted in.
You know what? You can make all the promises you want, but if you don't have the authority to fulfill that, their empty promises. But God's not like that. Every promise that God has given us, He is not overwanting, but He is able to fulfill those things.
Amen.
God doesn't say, oh, I just want Sister Valerie to be blessed so much, but I just don't know how to do it. No, not only does He want her to be blessed, but He is capable of blessing her. He is capable of giving her whatever she has need of. God's not just standing in the background saying, I want my children to be blessed. He will bless you. But the thing that you have to do is believe Him and not be deceived. So many times we come into the church and we come in, you know, and we're like little sheep. We really don't know anything. We come in and we just have this expectation of, oh, God's just going to do everything for me. When I came into the church, I thought, in my spirit, I thought God could do everything. And you know what? Pretty soon I started looking at people and it started chipping away at my faith.
Uh-huh.
I started looking at people's failures and I started looking at trials that I went to. And pretty soon it started chipping away at my faith. God wasn't any less able 10 years later than He was when I first met Him.
That's right.
It's because I allowed the things of the world and the things that I was going through to chip away at my faith and what I believed He could do.
That's right.
I started out good. It says, you did run well. You started out good. It's like a marathon. Everybody starts out good. They're all in the same pace. Everybody's going. Pretty soon, the first guy, he's still going. The 40th guy, he's still going. The 25,000th guy's going. Okay, I made it a mile. How much farther can we go? We all started out running real good.
Further than I did.
We all started out running real good.
5 years later.
But you know what? The thing that's amazing? The race that we're running, it's not the guy that crosses the finish line first. You know what it is? It may take that last person 15 hours to cross that finish line. It may take them 15 hours. And there are some that are determined. I don't care how long it takes. It can be tomorrow. I'm crossing that finish line.
Right.
They may literally be crawling, but they're going to cross that finish line. Don't let the world chip away your faith so much that you give up the race.
Amen.
Don't let things of life chip away from you that you don't finish the race. And I'm with you, Sister Jordan. It's kind of cold in here this morning.
Yeah,
I'm
just...
It's cold.
Guaranteed.
Don't let the things of the world chip away your faith. He says, oh, you foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you?
Kim said.
So many of us started out so well. We started out doing so good. And then we allowed the things, the trials and troubles, we allowed our own doubts. Because, you know, sometimes we'll ask God to do something for us, and we are just absolutely positive. We are sure this is God's will. I know this is God's will. I'll give you an instance. Sister Jean Ailes. So when Sister Jean Ailes got sick, it just absolutely flabbergasted us. And I remember going to I'd already left the Brooklyn church at that time, afterwards. And I remember going with Sister Mary and Sister Debbie and different ones, the happy side of the family. And we had absolute faith. We knew God was going to heal her. And we went up there, and they said, well, there's no hope. She doesn't have 3 months. And we stood and said, there's no way. She's not dying. She is absolutely not dying. And everybody in all the families like, you just have to come to the grips. Understand, you know, that's what the doctors have told us. She can't last past 3 months. She has to have a heart and lung transplant. She's not going to make it. And we kept saying, there's no way she's not going to die. You know, I'm trusting God. He is a healer, and we prayed for her. And we stood in prayer for her, and we stood in prayer for her. And we stood in prayer for her. And you know what? She did not die in 3 months. Now, the ones around us kept saying, we're just going to have to come to the understanding. We've seen this before. We know how. You can listen to the doctors, But you don't have to put your faith in the doctors.
Right.
My faith is not in man. My faith is in God.
Amen.
And so we continue to pray for her. We continue to pray for her. And yes, she did eventually die. But you know what? It didn't keep me from believing that God would heal her. It could have. It could have. I could have said, God, you lied to me. You lied to me. You said she wasn't going to die. Well, I hate to tell you this, people. We're all going to go. Either we're going into rapture or we're going by the way of the grave, one way or another. And if you don't go into rapture, you're going to go by the way of the grave at some point in time. Whether you are 16 hours old or 116 years old, you're going to go one way or the other. And you can't allow those things to take away your faith. It just didn't happen the way I said it was going to happen. I truly, in my heart, thought that God was just going to completely heal her. She was going to rise up, and she was going to go right back, and she was going to be, oh, God has healed me totally and completely. God did not heal her body totally and completely.
He made her whole.
But something else happened in that time also. In the time that she was sick, all the bitterness that she had for people who left the church, all the misunderstanding that she had, that why we left, all the things that were not right in her heart, God gave her opportunity to make right. So he healed her in a whole different way. He healed her in a way that we could never have done. And while she was in that afflicted area, that we kept saying, God's going to lift her up, God's going to raise her up, God's going to heal her. He healed her in a different way. Her heart was healed. I mean, when I first left the church, I would see people in Kmart, and they'd go down a different aisle. They wouldn't even look at me. I was no longer Sister Jennifer, and I'm not Sister Elle. She never treated me that way. She was always kind to me. She always thought I was deceived and didn't understand God. You know, until she came to that revelation, as Brother Else came to that revelation, maybe things aren't always as we see they are. Things aren't always as I think they are. And so God healed her in a whole different way. Her whole life began to change, and she began to see that maybe people don't have to live their life exactly like I live my life. Because she was brought up, if it's wrong for me, it's wrong for you. If God told me, then God's telling you. And as the pastor has said many times, you may be able to do a lot of things that I can't do. That has nothing to do with your walk with God.
That's right.
God can change a person. And he took that opportunity to change her heart and change her mind. And I'm so glad that he didn't knock me off. That I didn't allow the enemy to knock me off my faith base. He didn't take me away from what I believed in God. Some of you are going through trials and troubles right now, and I know the enemy has yapped in your ear, and he said, God promised you this, and he didn't give it to you. God told you he was going to have this, and he didn't give it to you. What kind of God do you serve? And that's what you hear in the world today.
Yeah.
Okay, if God saved that child from a burning car, why didn't he save that kid from a burning car? I don't know. I can't tell you that. All I know is God is able to do anything God wants to do. And one of these days, I'm going to be standing before him and I'm going to say, okay, Lord, I don't understand why this happened or this happened. And all of a sudden, I believe that you're going to have an aha moment about everything that ever happened in your entire life.
Yes.
Everything, what is it says, we look and we see through a glass darkly right now. You only see things in pieces. But one of these days, you are going to have complete, absolute understanding of why everything happened the way it happened. And you're going to have the mind of Christ, the complete mind of Christ. What an amazing time that's going to be. What a wonderful experience that's going to be. No more doubt, no more frustration. None of it. You're going to have complete understanding of why you went through what you did. Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain? If it be yet in vain. If therefore that ministereth, he therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit, and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Abraham had a relationship with God because of faith, not because of law. He did not walk with God and talk with God, and he was not blessed by God because he was perfect in the law. He walked with God and talked with God and was blessed by God because he had faith. It was his faith. I mean, face it, how many of you would take the child you waited for forever and ever and ever, you're 100-some years old, and you're going to take the child that God promised you, and you're going to take him up on a mountain, and you're going to sacrifice him? Here I've waited and waited and waited and waited for this. I've waited for this, and now you're telling me that you want me to put him on an altar and sacrifice him? I would say very few people in the world today would have that faith. Very few people would have that faith. But see, the thing is that God knew he would never have to do it. God already had a plan in motion. He just wanted to see, are you willing to do it? Are you willing? And that's what God is asking you today. Are you willing to step aside from some of the things that you want that you can draw closer to him? He's not asking a single one of you to sacrifice your child. He's not asking a single one of you to sacrifice your child. But he is asking each and every one of us to sacrifice some things in our life that we might draw closer to him. I heard a minister this morning saying, you know, everybody has New Year's resolutions. Everybody has New Year's resolutions. 90% of the United States is going to say, I'm going to lose weight this year. 10% are going to do it. 90% of Christians are going to say, I'm going to read my Bible more.
Be closer.
I'm going to read my Bible more. I'm going to have a better understanding of God. And I'm going to set aside 30 minutes every morning to read my Bible and talk to God. And I want you to know what's going to happen. You're going to sit down, and this means you're going to sit down, you're going to open your Bible, and you're going to begin to read. And all of a sudden, the shade, the sun is shining. Like, okay. So you reach around to close the shade, and you look out the window, and there's a car, there's a toy, something sitting out. Oh, I better get that before it gets ran over. So you put down your Bible, and you go out, and you pick up the toy, and you put it into the garage. And you look in the garage, oh, I've been meaning to put that up. And so you get busy in the garage, and you do this, and then you go back inside, and you go, oh, now I'm late for work. So you, what do? You grab your coat, and the next day you get up, you give every attention, and your alarm clock doesn't go off. You don't get the, and pretty soon, after 3-4 days, you just totally forget about reading. It's just not possible. It's not possible for me to do that. It is possible. You can do anything if you put your mind to it.
That's right.
So many of us choose not to make those sacrifices. It's too hard. It's too hard. It's too hard. I don't understand the word I'm reading when I read it. It's just like, does not make any sense to me. Well, if you can't read King James Version, pick up a different version. There's a lot of different versions out there. You know, New International Version, American Version. There's all kinds of study Bibles out there. Can I tell you how I learned the Word of God? How I learned the Word of God was a children's Bible study book with stories. Stories. You still have it? Stories. I remember right after I was saved, a man came to my door and he was selling children's storybooks. And he had a Bible storybook. And it, back then it was something like $5 or $6. And I was like, oh my gosh. But I bought it. Because when I first came to God, reading the Bible was, it was just not there. I could not get the shouts and doubts and wills nots and therefores. And I just could not get it. It just wasn't there. And so every day I would read that children's storybook and I got an understanding of what the Word of God was. I understood in a very short story what Moses did. I understood in a very short story what the Garden of Eden was. I understood what Abraham did. I began to read those stories and they became alive to me. So then when I opened up the Word and I read, I already had an understanding of what it was about.
That's right.
It's like, don't try running a 25-mile marathon if you can't walk 3 blocks.
I was going to say, when you come into Christ, your new babe, you don't expect the baby to pick up the encyclopedia and read it. Just like God don't expect you to pick up the Word of God and understand everything. There is a growing process.
That's right.
And you have to grow. And I've done it for years. I've read, if I get the Bible and I read a story and I say, I don't really understand it. I'll go to a Bible that I have for my kids and I'll read it and I'll go, oh, I see. Sometimes we have to reference.
Absolutely.
And go back.
And you know, I don't care if you've been in this way 35 years. If you do not understand the Word of God, you need to find a way to understand it.
Absolutely.
If you've been in this way 35 years, you need to somehow find a way to understand the Word of God. And if it's simply picking up a children's storybook that you can read through and see the amazing, wonderful miracles that God has done, to let you know that if He's done it for them, He can do it for you.
Right.
And don't think,
the storybook, I'm
72 years old. I'm 49 years old. I'm not picking up. Use whatever is available to you.
Right.
And that's why I said when you get on, like, there's so, but the Gateway, Bible Gateway is so easy to reference things. So once you get in and start looking at one thing, it's easy to find so many others. You put in one word and it'll give you 500 different scriptures where that one word is.
Right.
And it's an amazing thing. It's really good. It's so easy. So easy to get through. It really is. God wants you to know His Word because the Word is what's going to establish you and keep you. I mean, if you come into God and you come into the church and you devote your life to God and you don't do anything else, but just walk through the door, what are you getting? What are you getting? Coming through the door is not what it's about.
That's right.
You could get as much sitting at home, and I'm not saying don't come to church, but if the only thing you're going to get is sitting in front of a kid's cartoon, watching a children's cartoon about Christ, if it opens up your eyes to something, use what's available.
Sure. That's right.
When you come into here, but if you come in here with an open mind, you have to come in with an open mind, because I'm going to tell you right now, you can hear the Word of God through a lot of different ways.
That's right.
I'm going to sit up here for 45 minutes and talk, and some of you are going to walk out that door going, what on earth was that about? That was the most befuddled, mixed up bunch of, what was that about? And then somebody's going to walk away and go, I think I need to get closer to God.
Amen.
I think I need to go back to where I started. I think I need to get my spirit lined up with the Word. I think I need to start doing something. Something needs to change. Because when you're in this world, the enemy is out to seek, to kill, steal, and destroy.
Amen.
That's his job.
Right.
And he will do it in many, many ways. He will do it in many, many ways. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, that's me and you, we are the heathen.
Amen.
Did you know that?
Yeah.
We are not God's chosen people by choice. We're not. The Jewish people are God's children by choice. That's who He chose. Those are His children. Those are His birth children. Those are His. We're just heathen. We were. Let me rephrase that. We were just heathen. We were just Gentiles. We were just nothing. We were orphans in a home waiting for a daddy. And one day, Jesus Christ came into this world. And because of His birth, and because of His death, and because of His resurrection, we now are adopted children of God. And I want you to know and understand, in a court of law, an adopted child has the same legal rights as as a birth child.
Right.
There is no difference. You ask any mom who's ever adopted a child and put her whole heart into them, they will tell you, I couldn't have loved this child any more than if I'd given birth to them. They're mine. They are mine. They're mine. And that's how God feels about you and I. We're no longer sitting on the outside looking in. We are now on the inside realm.
Hallelujah.
We're on the inside realm. We've got instantaneous access to God.
Yes.
Through Jesus Christ. We're no more heathens. That heathen that was before, now we have that faith that came through Abraham.
Amen.
And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. For as many as are under the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is every one that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. How many of you today have not done one single solitary thing wrong? From your birth to your death, you would have never been able to sin. And you want to know how likely that is? Back in those days, when the priest would go into the holiest of holies, they would tie bells on his feet and a rope around his leg, so that when he went into the holiest of holies, if he had done anything wrong, he would die instantaneously. They would pull him out because nobody could go in after him. So they would tie a rope around his leg, so if he had sinned or done anything wrong, they would drag him out.
I thought there were some good conversations after he drug one out.
Can you imagine? You better know you were right. But you know what? It's not possible. And God knew that it was not going to be possible that we follow the law.
I was going to say that. He knows it wasn't possible. That's why he rent the veil. That's why they ripped it.
Exactly. He knew that it was not possible for human beings to follow the law. Come on, we can't even go 55 and a 55.
There you go.
Honestly. And if you say, when it says 55 miles an hour, if you can't say 55, because if you're going 49, you're not going 55.
That's right. If it says 55, why don't you go 55?
Yeah.
You can hardly get people go 20
miles
an hour. I put
mine on cruise.
But 55, try to stop at 55 when you come to a red light. That can happen. We break laws all the time. And we even break, we lie. Oh, how do you like my new outfit? So many people go, I love that. You're a liar. And it's the most hideous thing you've ever seen in your life. But you're not going to hurt their feelings and say, that's the most hideous thing in my life I've ever seen in my life.
I always tell people, yeah,
it looks
good on you. And that just goes to tell them, I don't like it, but you know, that's what you like.
Because we do. I just got my hair done. Don't you love this color? It's purple. Purple looks good on you. That's a lie, because purple doesn't look good on her. She's 57 years old. She does not need purple hair. That's just Sister Jennifer. That's not God. That's not God. Don't get me wrong. That's just my opinion. My opinion. I mean, you know, as long as they make blonde in the bottle or brown in the bottle, it'll never be gray. It's just the way it is. Some people love gray. That's great. Wonderful. If you're comfortable, I have no problem with that. My mother could not wait to be gray because she had an Aunt Peggy that put bluing in her hair. And it made their hair blue. Do you remember that?
Blue hair.
That was the big thing. Blue hair. If you were old and you had white hair and you put bluing in, oh my land. That was the top of the top. My mother could not wait to get white hair so she could put bluing in her hair and make it blue. That was a long time ago. But I remember it.
Did she do it?
Never did do it. Because that was a phase that came through. God doesn't care if you have purple hair, orange hair, blue hair, pink hair. He doesn't care. He really doesn't care. Or no hair. Absolutely. God doesn't care. God does not care. Do you understand? But at some point in time, we have to understand there are sacrifices that we have to make in this life. There are things that we have to give up. If it's drawing you away from God, you got to give it up.
Right.
If something comes up every church night that you can't make it, okay, what's wrong? What's wrong with this picture? What do I have to do? What do I need to do? If God is telling you, you need to be there, but I just can't find the time. I just can't find the time to read the Word. I can't find time to study the Word. I can't find time to talk about it. There is not a single person on the face of the earth that cannot find 1 minute a day to talk about God. Every day at lunchtime, my little boys fight over who's going to say the prayer. Because Samuel's going to a Catholic preschool right now. And they taught him a prayer. One of my other little kids, somebody taught him a prayer. So every day, we have to decide who's going to say the prayer over lunch today. And sometimes, they all three of them say a different prayer. Just because it's easier to let off. Okay, you say your prayer, and you can say your prayer, and you can say, you know? Let them pray.
That's right.
Yeah, let them pray.
Amen.
Let them pray. You know, children learn what you teach them, like Samantha said. She has the book that I read that gave me an understanding of what the Word was about, that I read to them, that she now reads to her children. That $5 or whatever it was that I invested back then has went a long, long way. And it's made a change and a difference in a lot of lives. Because I can tell you right now, it didn't just change my life. It changed my children and all the people that my children touch. It changed Sister Valerie because of that book that I read that gave me understanding, that drew me closer to God. She had a desire to serve God. And she began going to the Christian church in Paragon. I remember that. Things change when you decide to make a sacrifice. Okay, I'm going to do away with some things, and I'm going to just get closer to God. I need to know about God. How can you have peace if you don't know God? How can you have peace in this world if you don't know God? You have to know God. And some of the most angry, upset, frustrated people that I know do not have faith in God. They don't know how to have faith in God. They don't know how to reach out and get that peace. They don't know how to turn around and walk away. They don't have that understanding. And you can tell those who have an absolute understanding of who God is, because they'll just, okay? I'm just trusting God for it. What are you going to do? You can't do anything about it? You just have to trust God. I can't tell you how many my husband has told me that. If there's anything you can do about this, you're just going to have to leave it alone. You're just going to have to leave it alone.
That's right.
And that's some of the hardest things for a mama to do.
Yes.
Leave it alone. Some of the hardest things in the world for a mama to do is leave it alone.
Yes, it
Daddy's,
is.
Not so much. I've heard Brother Mark say that. She wants to do this, and I'm just like, and Tim's like, just gonna let stand on your own 2 feet. And I'm like, no, that happened.
Yeah,
mamas are different. Most mamas are different. Most mamas are gonna step out, and even, you're an enabler. You're an enabler. I don't care. I know I'm a dog. Here, big enabler. I know it. You can't help it. We are. Daddies are more level-headed. Yeah, how are they ever gonna learn if you don't let them in? Takes that happy medium. You're right. But now if we help them.
Yeah.
Just who we are, we're flesh. None of us are able to stand under the law. And he knew that. He knew that it was impossible for men to follow the law. And if you are trying to follow God through Tim and I talked about the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not their life. We're not under those Ten Commandments. Do you understand that? We're not under those Ten Commandments. We're under so much more than that. We are under so much more than just the Ten Commandments. If it was just the Ten Commandments that you had to live by, But oh, after the Ten Commandments gave a whole different book of commandments and laws. Whole different book of commandments and laws, and different things that they could and could not do. That was impossible. Impossible to follow through. Even the Ten Commandments, you can't even follow through with those. Because if you come to me today and say, "You look wonderful," I'm going to tell you, "I feel great." I love you, Sister Monica. Oh, you're not going to follow the law. It's impossible. We cannot do it. And aren't you glad we don't have to do it?
That's right.
Jesus Christ came that we do not have to worry about that law.
That's right.
What we have to worry about today is the law of love, mercy, and grace.
That's right.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, everything within you. And love your brother as yourself. That's what you got to do. Love your brother as yourself. What are you going to do? You're never going to steal. You're never going to cheat. You know, you're going to hurt the people around you.
If you love them, then that's where you will those things. If you keep that love, then all that other stuff will fall right into place.
That's why Jesus said to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I heard it quoted wrong this week. Do unto others as they do unto you. Nope. That's not the word. I was watching a show and somebody quoted it as, "Do you know what the Bible says? Do unto others as they do unto you." And I'm like, nope. I don't know what word you're reading, but it's wrong. It was a secular television show, not a Bible show. It's do unto others as you would have them do unto you. How do you want people to treat you? How do you want your life to portray Christ? Because people, whether you like it or not, you're a book being read by men. You're a book that the world is reading. They're looking at your life and they're saying, either I want to be just like that, I want that peace that they have, I want the mercy that they show, I want the grace that they show, or they're looking at your life going, I don't want anything to do with that. You're on one side of the stick or the other. And they're going to know you have faults and failures. And that's what you say when you fall on your face. I'm human. I make mistakes. I just have to go to God and ask Him to forgive me. And that gives them hope to know that they can do it too.
Sure.
That's the thing you got to say. I'm human and I make mistakes. I'm not perfect. I am not perfect. I am far from perfect. But I know that through Christ, I can make it.
I probably did.
I just put my own. She did.
Did you?
I am a human being. I am not perfect in my means.
But that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident, for the just shall live by faith. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. Christ shall redeem us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every one that hangeth on a tree. We're not under that law anymore. We are given the liberty, the freedom to follow after Christ.
Hallelujah.
That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Hallelujah. I'm no more on the outside. I'm on the inner ring. I'm on the inside, straight access to God. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men, though it be out of a man's covenant, yet if it be confirmed, no man disannulleth or addeth thereto. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not, and to seeds as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law which was 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of none effect. It doesn't matter what the law said. Jesus Christ came, and because of his birth, death, and resurrection, we're no longer under that. We are no longer under that. It is faith in Christ that makes us stand. It's faith in Christ. Your faith in knowing that He came that we might be on that inner circle. I'm going to jump down for just a few minutes. Go to 26. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. We are no longer on the outside. When you come to Christ and you give your life to Him and you decide that I'm going to serve Him no matter what comes my way, I'm going to have to make a few sacrifices. I'm going to have to make a few changes. I'm going to have to draw nigh to God. In the world that we live in today, you are going to have to get closer and closer and closer to Him, or you are going to be deceived. Because the world will tell you anything and everything is okay, and everybody's going to go to heaven. God's not going to send anybody to hell. If He's a loving God, He's not going to send anybody to hell. And they're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. God is not going to send a single person to hell. If you get there, it's because you chose to put yourself there.
That's right.
Because God has already made a way of escape.
That's right.
Nobody has to go there. And it's not even a hard thing to do. It's not like He's asking you to sacrifice your oldest child.
That's right.
He's not saying, I want you to sacrifice your firstborn to me. All He's saying is, have faith. Believe. Have faith and believe and know that I'm God. And whatever you ask, knock, seek, ask, just believe me. You have a need in your life? You ask God. You seek Him. And how do you seek Him? How do you know what God wants for you in your life? Get in the Word of God. He's going to show you what He wants for you in your life. But the first thing you have to do is be willing to seek Him. You can't just sit back on your do little and do nothing and expect God to do everything. You are not saved by the law. You are saved by grace. But once that grace and that faith and that love comes in, you're going to make changes. You're going to see changes in your life, and people are going to see changes. And you're going to make changes in this world because you have Him in your life and you're no longer that same person anymore. That's the most wonderful thing about God. He doesn't expect you to do anything, but you do it because of Him. Face it. When you love your children, you want the very best for them. And sometimes you go out of your way to give them what they have need of. God went out of His way. He could have kept the law. He could have said, let the law die. But that wasn't God. That wasn't His plan. He made man, and all He wanted to do was just have somebody to talk to and to be with and to love and to show His love. And when Adam and Eve fell on their face, He said, okay, now I've got to make another way. I have to make a way that they will spend eternity with me. Is that not just like a mama?
Yes.
Okay, you fell on your face. Now let's figure out a way to make this. Oh, absolutely. He could have taken away our freedom of choice. And He could have said, this is exactly how you're going to behave. You're going to do this, 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 and this. But then you wouldn't really be serving Him. You would be enslaved with Him. Because a slave does what they're told to do or else. I'm not a slave to God. I'm a child of God. I don't ever want to be or feel like I'm a slave to God. Because some people think that you're in slavery if you're a Christian. Oh, you got to do this, you got to go to church, you got to do that. I'm not a slave to God. I'm a child of God. And I want to be in His presence. Just like I hope. Like we had Thanksgiving. We had almost 40 people at our house. They didn't come because they had to be there. They came because they wanted to be there. We had a good time. We had a good reason. Everybody had fun. God wants you to come to Him because you love Him and you want to be a part of Him. And He doesn't want you to be deceived. He doesn't want you to start out in the spirit and end up trying to finish this in the flesh. And it's not to the fastest guy that gets over the finish line. It's to the guy that endures to the end. You may not be running full force right now. But the second wind is coming.
Come on.
Your second wind is coming.
Amen.
Many times, we feel like I'm on my last leg. I can't do anymore. And then you get that second wind, that second burst of energy, and wham, you're on your way. You're on your way. Don't ever count that out. Doesn't matter what you're going through or where you're going. Hold fast to what you know is true.
You started this thing in the Spirit, finish this thing in the Spirit. You started this thing believing that God can do all things, you're going to finish this thing believing God can do all things. Don't let the things of this world to deceive you. God is not, oh, I just let them.
He'll take care of all that in the end.
But one thing too is that where we explain to the kids, like in church and stuff, you know, there's wheat, there's tares as well in churches.
Right.
And the thing, the difference between people and plants is people can change from tares.
He said, let them grow.
And God can change them from tares to wheat.
Right, let them grow.
Let them grow. Get the same nutrition.
Yeah, let them grow. So they can be changed. It's God's business. I'm not going to call him in because I was sworn in secrecy. Anyway. there'd be a choir practice immediately after Sunday school. And from every Sunday from now on, the choir practice, day at 4. We're going to be doing the caroling. So that's why. Play practice tomorrow. This is right. The dates are right, correct on this? The second? Okay. I was just making sure. Yeah, we're going to Christmas carol on the 4th, which is Wednesday at Grandview. And we're going to start at 6. We're going to meet here at 6 or?
We'll probably just meet out at Grandview. It's across from the emergency room.
Yeah.
Where that's at.
Yeah.
And we just go, you can go into the front door or the side door, but we'll meet in the cafeteria.
At 6?
Yeah, at 6. We'll meet in the cafeteria. So we'll start singing in there, and then we'll
probably
go through the hall.
That's done, too. We're not going to be able to be there. We might make it, but I don't know.
Who's George?
Why? George? George Ann. I don't know if this is the 17th is about, but maybe the 10th or some portraits.
He's
got an
orchestra.
He's
letting everybody know that they're welcome to come if
they'd
like.
Lisa wants you. Lisa wants you for some reason.
You did.
At Christmas program on the 19th of December, we got a lot of practice to do now and then.
Yes.
A lot of practice. Yes.
Our secret sister luncheon at 1 o'clock on the 14th.
Everybody hear that? I don't know nothing about that. I don't need to know.
Secret Sisters.
Secret Sisters. Luncheon.
1 o'clock.
On the 14th.
It won't last very long. It's just be a light luncheon and an exchange and so forth.
She said bring a flashlight for some reason. In the fellowship hall. On the 14th at 1 o'clock. Forget it. All right. I'm sorry. Our attendance this morning was. Is that all? Do you have anything else to say?
Did you say about the everyone in the play? I'm going to have a rehearsal, a dress rehearsal, so we can set up all the. Can you set that?
Oh. No.
And the Wednesday, the 18th, the day before our program, I like for everyone that's in the play. That means choir, that means the people that's doing the props, everybody that's going to be involved behind the scenes and in the scenes to come so we can go through it and set up, because we'll have to tear all this equipment down and move it and get everything set up and ready. I would like for everybody to be here by 7, if that's okay.
What are we wearing in the choir?
Well, that's what I was going to say. Sister Daisy did go over to the archives. No, I'm just joking. I just had to say that. And Sister Daisy did go out and in all the storages and stuff, and she found our choir robes, the red and black. I don't know how many. Do you remember how many you have?
One of them, I think, has got 9, and the other's got 8 in it, so I'm not sure exactly.
So
17. There's plenty of rows.
So you can, if you like, I'd like for you to wear red and black, anything Christmassy, you know, for the thing. And then we'll have our robes, of course, also. That's why I want to do the dress rehearsal, so we can, like I said, set up the scenes, and we can get the choir set in where they need to be, and get everything just done.
I won't be here having surgery Thursday, so I'm going to be late at Grandville Trace.
So you're not going to be on the play at all? You ain't going to be out by the 19th?
No, I don't know. It just depends, you know.
Okay.
How soon I heal.
Well, you hear that, guys? Yes. She's not going to be able to be here, but she'll be here in our hearts, and we can pray for her spirit through.
Get healed, that's the main thing.
Yes,
get well.
Yes, get well.
That's so more important.
Also,
Lisa, did you guys do that? The choir, all the choir that can, that is in the choir, I would like for you to encourage Lisa. I'm not a very encourager, I'm sorry, but I'm going to try. They're doing a nursing home.
Wednesday.
Yeah, they're going to do the caring. I can't do it on Wednesdays. I'm sorry. I'm already obligated to my grandma and my parents, which I have been all year. It's not something I just made up. So if you can, the ones that are able, it's
anybody.
Yeah, anybody. They don't have to be in the choir, but I mean, I like for our choir to be in
the first. Anybody would like to sing. Anybody would like to sing.
And then the next setup, I hope they do it on a Friday night or a Saturday evening. Yeah.
I just did it on
the first. That's all. Oh, and we got choir.
Choir. What's that?
Good. We'll be there.
Okay. Attendance this morning was 53, and the tithes and offerings was $1,191. Say, as far as you want to sing before?
Yeah.
Okay. Choir? Anybody that's here in the choir?
Thank you. page 408 in our songbooks if you'd like to help us.
408.
Page 408.
Shining round about me, and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon my feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. And here's the thing. When he got knocked off his high horse, it was all about him. He was persecuting the Jews. He was put to death. And he took pride in the fact that I'm part of the king's
Inner circle.
Yes, inner circle. Thank you. He put himself up on a pedestal. And God knocked him down. Instead of being patient and waiting on God. And of course, the more I did, the more I built myself up. And I fell. I won't go into how I fell, but God put me down to where I had to humble myself. He does. And the thing was, I had the mindset that it was all about me and what I could do. And I learned the hard way. This isn't about me. This isn't about Sister Jennifer. This isn't about Brother Pat.
That's right.
This is about bringing souls into the kingdom.
Hallelujah.
The sooner we learn that, the easier our life gets.
Yes.
We don't have to like everybody. We have to love them.
Yeah.
That was another lesson that I learned. That was a hard one for me to learn because I couldn't figure out how to like someone, or how to not like someone, but yet love them.
Yeah.
You can't be mean to someone. Love them.
True.
Okay. You can love somebody and not like them. You don't. Jesus said that he loves the sinner but hates the sinner. Okay.
That's right.
We all have sin in our lives. We all have things to overcome. Some things it may be till the day we die before we're ever delivered from.
Amen.
But we still have to learn to control that.
Keep trying.
Because the day we quit trying is the day that we've not finished the race.
Yeah,
I stand back and I keep asking God why He gives me the hard lessons to learn. I listened to some of the other teachers, and I knew how they went through some of the same lessons, but their lessons weren't as hard as mine. Loving each and I have done nothing but be nice to him. I kind of feel like Brother Ron. I'm not making a pot. Within the last year, he has become not so nice. I mean, his children have out flat out threatened me. He has come to me and said, "Why did you say this to this person?" And I mean, I point blank asked him, "What you doing?" I've never said outside of my own door anything bad about the man. And it's all over a piece of property. That was the thing. It was all over a piece of property. That was the lesson where I had to love this man when my flesh just wants to take my shotgun and blow holes inside of his house. That's the point that I got to with the man. But I had to learn how to love him. I don't speak to him if I sit him out unless I've spoken to him. As Wendy put it, we coexist. And it was a hard lesson for me to learn. Just like the whole, I'm an offensive defensive driver. The one thing I don't like more than anything is people that run on the old side and cut me off.
Yes.
And Wendy told me one day, it was after church, wasn't it? We were going out and on the bypass of Morgan Street. I had the green light, and this car came up flying up Morgan Street, and I knew he was going to cut me off. And I started griping, and at the same time I started griping, she says, "Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And I felt like money flew through right at that point. We have to forgive them. Even Jesus forgave the Romans and the Jews at the time, the priests and the Pharisees at the time that they murdered him. They knew that they didn't know what they were doing. Some of life's lessons to each of us seems to be the hardest thing that we ever do. But I'm here to tell you, if you'll be patient in your trials, God will work it out.
Yeah.
Because the Bible says that all things work. Yes, work for good to those that. According to his purpose. If we're patient, all things will work out.
Yes.
I love you. Thank you.